Tantor Audio presents Ultima by Stephen Baxter. Narrated by Kyle McCarley. 1. In the heart of 100 billion worlds, across a trillion dying realities in a lethal multiverse, in the thonic silence, there was satisfaction. The network of mind continued to push out in space, from the older stars, the burned-out worlds, to the young, out across the galaxy. Pushed deep in time, too, twisting the fate of countless trillions of lives. But time was short, and ever shorter. In the dream of the end time, there was a note of urgency. Chapter 1. AD 2227. AUC, ab urbe condita, after the founding of the city, 2980.
Danger, Yuri Eden! Danger!
Call you? What's the emergency? Another prox flare? We need to get to the shelter.
Be calm, Yuri Eden. You are no longer on Per Ardua.
Beth and Mardina, where?
Your daughter and her mother are far from here.
Far? Are they safe?
That I cannot tell you, Yuri Eden. We must carry on in the presumption that they are.
So why did you yell danger in my ear?
It was the only way to wake you, Yuri Eden. The drugs the medicus has been prescribing for you are rather random in their effects, although they are satisfactorily strong.
So you lied, right? Since when was an autonomous colonization unit programmed to lie?
I fear I have exceeded the parameters of my initial programming rather extensively by now, Yuri Eden.
You know, I feel like I'm blundering down a dark corridor, and I open one door after another, trying to make sense of it all. But I'm safe when I'm asleep.
Take your time, Yuri Eden.
Medicus. That word. I'm still on that damn Roman tub, aren't I?
We are still guests aboard the Malleus Jesu, yes.
And, oh!
The Medicus would advise you not to try to sit up, Yuri Eden.
When I sleep, I forget the crap growing inside me. I forget it all.
It's still here. But so am I, my friend. So am I. Here with you.
Well, I can see that. So why the hell did you wake me?
You asked me to. Well, to be precise, you asked me to witness and record your last will and testament. I can do that for you. But you have been asleep many hours, Yuri Eden. I thought it best to wake you before...
Before the time comes when I never wake up at all, right?
It was Steph Kalinsky's suggestion.
It would be. How is she, by the way?
The last time I communicated with her, she was drinking hardened legionaries under the table. Anything to get the taste of the Romans' disgusting fish sauce out from between her teeth. That is close to a direct quotation.
She'll outlive us all. Her and her impossible twin, probably.
I hope to learn that someday. Yuri Eden, we must press on.
Before I pass out again. It's okay, old pal. So, my last will and testament. What kind of legal form can we use that will be recognizable in the Roman system? Whatever the hell that is, 2,000 years after the Empire was supposed to have fallen, It's not as if I have much to leave anybody anyhow. Only the stuff we walked through that final hatch with.
Including myself.
Including yourself, buddy. It's strange to think of you as property, but I guess that's how it is.
I am only an AI, Yuri Eden. And in this different reality, human beings are property, some of them. Some even on this interstellar vessel. So I am less of an exception than you would imagine here. We cannot change such things.
Maybe not. But my instructions are clear enough. If Steph survives me, my share of you, in the Roman's eyes, is to go to her. If she doesn't survive me, you go to Beth on Earth. If by some miracle you can find her.
Quintus Fabius has promised me he will make sure of it, Yuri Eden, with the support of the Legion's Collegia.
So, let's begin. I was born in 2067, old style. Getting on for 160 years ago then, even though I have only lived
62 years, Yuri. The name your parents gave you
is irrelevant. I was born in North Britain. My parents were both members of the heroic generation who struggled to save the world from the climate jolts of the previous decades. Well, they succeeded. And before the prosecutors caught up with them, they had me cryo-frozen at age 19. Just as well they never saw me revived on Mars a century later.
Your name, though?
Some joker called me Yuri when they hauled me out of the cryo-tank.
Very well. And after a year on Mars?
I was caught up in an ISF sweep, with a little help from the peacekeepers at Eden, who were sorry to see me go.
You are being sarcastic.
Yeah, flag it. Found myself waking up again aboard the ISF ship Ad Astra. A colonel-driven interstellar hulk full of press-ganged losers like me. I made myself popular once more. So I spent, 24 years on Per Ardua, planet of Proxima Centauri, with Mardina Jones and our baby, Beth, and you, call you, struggling to stay alive. We found other colonists, stranded as we had been, and we fought our way to the hub of the world, the substellar. There we found
a hatch.
A step through, just that, and we were back on planet Mercury, across 4 light years. So everything changed yet again, for humanity, for me. I had taken Mardina and Beth home, and that's where they stayed.
But you couldn't stay with them.
For me, it was to go back to Ardua or face jail. So back to Ardua it was, with Steph Kalinsky at my side, who has her own issues with all of this, by the way.
Are you tiring, Yuri Eden?
Don't fuss, call you. I hate it when you fuss. Back to the story. So, on Ardua, the UN started to clamp down, just like it had in the solar system, because war was brewing up. A war to be fought with kernel-powered ships over the loads of kernels on Mercury.
Yuri Eden?
Still here, call you.
Do you remember how we drove to the antistellar point? The darkest, coldest place on Per Ardua, in the deepest shadow of Proxima, where we found, among other mysteries, another hatch.
Yes, the hatch. And we stepped through, Steph and I, and you. We found ourselves under the light of another star. And there was a man in a cloak and a helmet, striding towards us. Quid est this?
Yes. Do you remember, Yuri Eden?
Quid agitis in ac provincia?
Chapter 2. AD 2222. AUC 2975. The intruders at the hatch emplacement were first spotted by sharp-eyed Arab navigators aboard the Malleus Jesu. In their quiet chambers aboard the interstellar craft circling high above this world, the Arabs, doubling as observers and map-makers here at the destination, routinely scrutinized the area around the hatch through their far watchers. The newly minted hatch was the key objective of the mission, after all, and deserved surveillance and protection. And now, Centurion Quintus Fabius himself was in the air, on the way to investigate. The leather sack of the aerial Cetus creaked and snapped as the great craft shifted in the light wind. Quintus was standing alongside the command position, a bank of levers worked by a Remex, one of the junior crew who reported to Movina, the Triarchus, the commander of the ship itself. Like Movina, this Remex was a Brachanti, and just as arrogant and sullen as Movina herself and all her kind. And yet you couldn't argue about his competence. As he stroked his levers, great paddles shifted in the air around the flank of the Cetus, and the craft moved sweetly in response, heading towards the hatch, which stood open on the scarred plain that Quintus's engineers had made when they had unleashed the hot breath of the kernels on this world and created this wonder. The bridge of the Cetus was a clutter of controls and instruments, and scuffed wooden tables on which lay heaped charts and itineraries, mappings of this world hand-drawn since the expedition's arrival 3 years ago. The air was redolent with the characteristic scent of the Brachanti, the folk of the uncivilized north, with the mead they drank and the treated hog leather they wore, and the tang of the Valhallan tobacco they liked to chew as they worked. But this mundanity terminated at the window, before which an alien world unfolded before Quintus's eyes. Even after 3 years, even after he had walked so much of it, and even after he had changed its face significantly by building roads and camps and the permanent colony, and of course creating the hatch, still Quintus found this world astounding. The hatch itself had been set on a scrap of higher land, overlooking a plain on which native vegetation sprawled, a low scrub of purple and white studded with odd orange cones. The Greek philosophers aboard assured Quintus that the cones were communities of creatures, mostly too small to see, cities of the invisible, each mound a Rome of the germs. Further away, the land rose up, ascending towards lofty mountains before which foothills stood in attendance. And those mountains and hills, each a massive plug of volcanic rock, had been shaped, with terraces and walls and mighty crenellations that cast sharp shadows in the unchanging mother-of-pearl light of the principal sun, Romulus. They were mountains turned into fortresses by beings who had once lived here, and remade their world, and vanished. Blown themselves to bits, no doubt, Quintus had heard his gloomier legionaries conclude in the camps. And yet those mountain sculptors evidently shared something with the rudest legionary from the poorest province of the Empire. They had built hatches. Well, Quintus had brought his ship here, and the engineers and the legionaries and the slaves had built their own hatch, and their names would be remembered for it, the ancient number of the legion of which this century was a part, inscribed at the foot of the stone cross of Jesu that was the only human monument permitted to accompany a hatch. This was forever Quintus's hatch, And this world, the fourth of the family that surrounded this stellar twin, Romulus, would, once the permanent colonia was formally dedicated by the Vicarius, become the latest province of a Roman Empire that had now reached to the stars themselves. This was what he had achieved, he, Quintus Fabius. This was what he had bought at what would be the cost of 13 years of his own life away from home, and, thanks to the mysteries of near light-speed travel, a sundering by many more years than that from the family and friends he had left behind. It was a price he paid gladly. To command such a vessel as the Malleus Jesu, on such a mission as this, to build a hatch, was the pinnacle of his career so far, and likely not to be surpassed, he reminded himself with a twinge of resentment, as it was rare for officers from the provinces to rise much further in the Imperial Army, unless you were wily enough for intrigue and assassination. Yet the hatch was not for Fabius, or his crew, or any human. The hatch was a thing in itself, its own purpose as ineffable as that of a temple to a forgotten god. And now, as he peered down from a washed-out sky, the perfection of the hatch and its setting was ruined by the intruders. As the Cetus made its ponderous way towards the hatch position, Quintus felt his temper boil up, and he clenched and unclenched one massive fist, feeling the muscles in his arm work. "Two of them," said Gnaeus Junius. Gnaeus was Quintus's optio, his second in command. Gnaeus was peering down at the hatch location through a finely wrought Greek far watcher, leather and glass in a wooden tube.
"Give me that!"
Quintus grabbed the instrument from Gnaeus's hands and held it up to his eye. As usual, at first he saw only darkness.
"You need not squint so much, sir."
"I'm angry. When I'm angry, I squint."
"Yes, sir. You also grind your teeth."
"No, I don't."
"No, sir."
Slim, dark, elegant, his tunic always spotless, Gnaeus Junius was an equestrian, a member of one of Rome's oldest aristocratic pedigrees. Gnaeus, though so young, was likable, flawlessly competent, and had displayed none of the arrogance or sense of entitlement redolent of so many of his class. Quintus had found him utterly dependable. None of which saved Quintus from a sour resentment that this boy was destined to rise far higher in the army and beyond it than Quintus himself ever could. That the only way Quintus could avoid having to report to this elegant boy some day would be retirement. Now, Gnaeus reminded him calmly of the issue in question.
"So about the intruders, sir. Two of them."
Quintus studied the strangers through the Far Watcher.
"A man and a woman. Old enough, in their 50s or older. That makes them older than any of our veterans or their wives. Save maybe Titus Valerius of the 7th cohort, who I know for a fact has been lying about his age for a decade. Some men just don't want to retire."
"Yes, sir."
"Well, even Titus is going to have to retire now. The Colonia, that's his job now, for all the grumbling."
A morning of trying to deal with complaints from the colonists, the veterans who would be left behind on this world, had soured Quintus's mood even before this business of the intruders.
"Nothing will grow in this foreign muck, Centurion."
"You can't leave me on the same planet as Caius Flavius, Centurion. He's had his eye on my wife since the Valhalla Superior campaign, and now he's leering at my daughter."
"I swear, Centurion, I swear."
Gnaeus said tactfully,
"Well, those aren't any of our veterans down there, sir, or their families.
nor are they any of the Remiges. He was right. 8 subjective years after leaving Terra, including 5 years cooped up on the ship itself, Quintus was sure he would recognize any of the ship's crew and passengers, even the lowliest slave. The complement of the Malleus Jesu was a few hundred, not counting the slaves, with the core of it being the 80 men of Quintus's century and an equal number of Remiges, the ship's crew, known by an archaic term deriving from a word for rowers, mostly Bricanti, with their own hierarchy and their own officers under the sullen Movina, along with their families. But he did not recognize the intruders below.
"They look like Bricanti, you have to give them that,"
he murmured.
"Those odd clothes, jackets and trousers rather than tunics and cloaks. Peculiar colors, aren't they? Packs on their backs. And what's that pale sparkle on their shoulders? Looks almost like frost melting. Impossible, of course. No frost on this world. Not on the day side, anyhow."
"And no sign of weapons," Naya said practically. Quintus grunted.
"I'd want to strip them down and turn out their packs before I could be sure of that. At least they're not sheen."
Nias pursed his lips. "I wouldn't jump to conclusions, sir. The Sheen Empire is larger than ours, and includes many ethnicities. Even if not Sheen themselves, they could be provincials, agents, even mercenaries." Quintus sighed.
"The tripolar politics of Terra reaching out to us even here, eh, Optio? Us, the Bricanti, and the Sheen."
"Well, the Bricanti are our allies, sir, and we're not actually at war with the Sheen."
"You mean we weren't when we left home?"
"True, sir."
The craft was descending now, with a rattle of chains as ground anchors were dropped from a lower deck. Quintus grabbed his cloak from where he had flung it over the back of a chair and tied it around his neck, checked his sword and ballista were at his belt, and jammed his plumed helmet on his head. Nias frowned.
"You're going to interrogate them yourself, sir?"
"By Christ's tears, I am!"
"I think it's best if you approach these people with an open mind, if I may say so."
If they are Bricanti or Sheen, I need to observe the proper diplomatic protocols before I throw their arses in the brig. Is that your thinking?"
"Sir, we didn't bring these people here. I mean, on the Malleus Jesu. And so the only way they can have got here..."
Somehow, this elementary observation hadn't impressed itself on Quintus's consciousness.
"You are saying that unless they walked hundreds of miles from one of the indigenous hatches, the only way is through that hatch, which we ourselves constructed..."
"And which has evidently connected itself to the wider network of hatches, just as it should. But we don't know where that connection will have been made to. Perhaps to some place even more exotic than the cities of Far Sheen."
Quintus, through his temper, saw the sense behind this reasoning.
"So we don't know where they're from, how they got here, or what they can do. Therefore, we don't know what threat they may represent to us. The ship, our mission, even the Empire."
"No, sir."
"Well, the sooner we find out, the better. Let's get this over with. Back me up, Optio."
And he strode without hesitation to the stair to the lower deck. Behind him, he heard the Optio snap out commands, hastily assembling a guard unit from on-duty legionaries. It was a relief for Quintus to hit the ground at the bottom of the ladder, to leave the confinement of the aerial whale, and to be able to stride out towards the intruders, putting all his energies into the simple action of walking, to work out his frustrations in motion, in physical exercise. That had been his way since he had been a young bull of a raw recruit in the victorious 90th Legion, unable to combat the shadows of privilege, preference, and nepotism that had blighted his career in the army from the very beginning. Walking was one thing, but having somebody to punch out would be even better. But that didn't appear to be a likely option today. The two elderly intruders just stood there by the hatch emplacement, watching him approach. They looked somewhat startled, as you might, he thought, if you had just passed through the mysteries of a hatch itself. But they did not seem afraid, did not seem daunted by the prospect of a fully armed centurion of the Roman army bearing down on them as if he had a colonel up his arse. One of them, the man, even called out something. The words sounded vaguely familiar to Quintus, the accent odd, stilted. Time for a parade ground bellow, Quintus decided. Chapter 3. The craft overhead was like a tremendous airship. It moved smoothly, silently. It bore a symbol on its outer envelope, crossed axes with a Christian cross in the background, and lettering above. S.P.Q.R. Anchors of some kind were dropped from a fancy-looking gondola. When the craft had drifted to a halt, a rope ladder unrolled to the ground, and, as Yuri Eden and Steph Kalinsky watched, astonished, a hatch opened, and a man clambered down the ladder. As soon as he reached the ground, the man started towards them. He wore a plumed helmet and a scarlet cloak over what looked like a bearskin tunic. His lower legs were bare, above strapped-up boots. He had a sword on one hip and a gaudy-looking handgun in a holster on the other. Yuri called,
"Who the hell are you?"
The man, striding steadily, started shouting back.
"Fortasse accipio oratio stridens vestri, sum Quintus Fabius, centurio navis stellae Malius Jesu. Quid estis, quid agitis in ac provincia, et quid est mixti lingua vestri? Germanicus est? Non dubito quin vos ex Germaniae exteriorae. Coniovi de genus vestri prius. Bene? Quam respondebitis mihi?"
Always another door, Yuri thought.
"Let me handle this."
He spread his hands and walked forward towards the angry stranger.
"I think I understand your guttural speech. I am Quintus Fabius, centurion of the star vessel Malius Jesu. Who are you, and what are you doing in this province? And what is that mongrel tongue of yours? German, is it? From outer Germania, no doubt. I've dealt with your sort before. Well, what have you got to say for yourselves?"
The fellow said something to his female companion and walked forward, apparently undaunted. But at least he spread his hands, Quintus observed, showing he was unarmed. Gnaeus Junius caught up with Quintus, panting. Glancing over his shoulder, Quintus saw a small squad of legionaries had followed the optio, all according to regulations.
"You're out of breath, Gnaeus. Double your daily exercise period for the rest of the month."
"Thank you, sir. Do you really think they're from outer Germania? Well, I suppose you should know."
"And why is that, Gnaeus Junius? Because even though my mother tongue is a purer Latin than yours, my father was from Germania Inferior, and my mother was from Belgica. Which to the likes of you means I may as well be Transrhenus myself, is that it?"
"Of course not, sir."
We're not all moon worshippers and bear shaggers, you know.
I'm relieved to hear it, sir.
And my ancestors did put up a hell of a fight. The legions had to drive us all the way to the coast of the Mare Suvicum before they were subdued.
As you've pointed out before, sir.
So don't try to flatter me, Naius Junius.
Sir.
You're very bad at it.
Sir, the intruder is doing something with his pack.
Quintus saw that the man had turned away from his companion, the woman, and she was opening up the pack on his back for him. Quintus and Naius immediately drew their ballistae, their handguns. Quintus heard the senior man of the squad behind him murmur brusque commands. The male stranger, seeing the Roman's reaction, spread his empty palms wide once more and again called out.
We should jump them, Quintus said.
Give them a moment, sir, Naius said. They're speaking again. That tongue does sound more Germanic than not, but you know, I would swear I can hear a third voice, neither the man's nor the woman's.
Quintus glanced around sharply. The two strangers were alone.
Your hearing is either better than mine, Optio, or worse.
As if it's coming from the pack on the man's back.
A belly speaker? But we are rather far from any theater here. I'll not be amused by trickery.
The woman was closing up the pack now. Evidently, she had found what she wanted. She held two compact nodules of a smooth white substance, like small marble pebbles.
Whatever that is, Naius murmured, it's surely too small to be a weapon.
Now who's jumping to conclusions?
The woman handed one of the nodules to her companion. They were both watchful of the Romans, and were evidently endeavouring to make sure Quintus's men could see everything they were doing. Cautiously, they each pressed a nodule into one ear. And when the man spoke again, Quintus was startled to discover he could understand his words.
Is the translation correct? Can you understand me?
He speaks Latin.
Naius breathed.
Rather stilted. Formal Latin.
Quintus growled.
If they could speak Latin all the while, why address us in German?
Perhaps they could not speak it,
Naius said, puzzling it out.
Perhaps it is those nodules in their ears that speak it for them, for I think I hear a trace of the German behind the louder Latin words. Or perhaps it is the little fellow they carry in the pack on the man's back who knows the Latin.
And who belly speaks for the other two, I suppose? Your imagination runs away with you, Optio.
This is a strange situation, sir. Perhaps imagination is what we need.
Let's get down to reality.
Quintus put his weapon back into its loop at his belt and stepped forward, bunched fists on hips.
What is your mission here?
The strangers exchanged glances.
We have no mission.
And here the speaker stumbled, as if searching for a precise term.
We are scouts.
The two of them pulled the white pods away from their ears and spoke in their own tongue briefly.
Scouts? For what army? Are you Bricanti or Sheen or Roman? To which emperor do you pay your taxes?
Naius murmured,
The Bricanti don't have an emperor, sir.
Shut up.
The woman said now,
Our speaker has not the right word. We are...
Another hesitation.
Philosophers. We came through the door.
The hatch, said Naius.
Yes, very well, the hatch. We came to discover what is here, on this world. not as part of a military force. They're saying they're explorers, sir. Quintus grunted.
They're lying, then. Romans don't explore any more than Alexander did. Not for any abstract purpose. Romans discover, survey, conquer.
But they aren't Romans, sir. Quintus repeated.
What emperor do you serve?
The strangers exchanged a glance.
We serve no emperor. Our province is unconquered.
Again, they looked uncertain at the translation. Quintus scoffed.
Nowhere on Terra is unconquered, save for the icy wastes of the south. Flags fly everywhere. Somebody's flag, at least. And more than one if there's a war in progress.
The woman tried again.
We recognize none of the names you mentioned. None of the polities.
Naya said,
Then you can't come from Terra.
The woman looked at him frankly.
Not from your Terra.
Nias's eyes widened. Quintus was baffled and frustrated.
What do you mean by that? Perhaps your country has vanished under conquest, like the kingdom of the Jews. Perhaps your people are slaves.
No, the woman said firmly. We are not slaves.
She seemed to listen for a moment.
Very well, Kalyu, I'll emphasize that. We are freeborn.
Nias asked,
Who are you speaking to? Who is... Kalyu? Kalyus? We are freeborn, the woman said again. Strangers to you, strangers in this place, but freeborn. We ask for your protection.
Protection?
Quintus rapped his breastplate.
What do you think I am? A vicarius? A Bible scholar? So you don't have nations. You don't have owners. Do you have names? You?
He jabbed a finger at the woman.
My name is Stephanie Karen Kalinsky.
And you?
The man grinned, almost insolently.
Yuri Eden.
Quintus glanced at Nias.
What do you make of that? Stephanie sounds Greek, respectable enough. But Yuri? Scythian? Hun?
Their names are as exotic as their appearance, sir.
Nias murmured.
Oh, I've had enough of this. We've a lot to get done before the Malleus Jesu can leave this desolate place. The sorting out of the veterans and their colonia for a start. I've no time for philosophical conundrums. Disarm them. Take them as slaves. Find some use for them if they have any. And if all else fails, find a suitably economical way to dispose of them.
Nias looked unhappy, but he nodded.
Yes, sir.
The woman stepped forward sharply.
Quintus Fabius, you're making a mistake to dismiss us. We can be useful to you.
He laughed.
How? You're too old to be a concubine. Too flabby and soft to fight. What, can you cook?
She tapped her skull.
We have knowledge. Knowledge you don't share.
Nias said hastily,
She may have a point, sir. We still don't know anything about these people, how they came to be here. The Greeks have a saying, Knowledge is the most potent weapon.
Quintus grunted his contempt for that.
A phrase no doubt cooked up by some shiny-domed philosopher when Roman legionaries first came to his hometown waving their swords.
He's right, the woman said. It would be irresponsible of you to discard us without being sure.
Quintus roared.
Irresponsible? Do you presume to tell me my duty, woman?
But Kalinsky held her ground.
For example, perhaps we have knowledge to share of a common enemy. she thought it over. An enemy of Rome, stronger and more wily than even the Sheen and the Bricanti, Gnaeus prompted. Quintus demanded,
Of what enemy do you speak?
She gestured at the installation behind her. I speak of whoever wishes these hatches to be built to straddle the stars, and who manipulates the destinies of mightier empires even than your Rome to make it so. But now the man, Yuri Eaton, seemed distracted by something. Apparently oblivious of the conversation, he took a step forward. The legionaries reacted, drawing their weapons and pulling closer to their commander. Quintus, too, made to draw his ballista. But Gnaeus laid a restraining hand on his arm and pointed into the sky.
It is the sunrise, sir. He is puzzled by it.
Remus was rising, the second star of this double system, brighter than Lunar or Venus, brighter than any star in the sky of Terra. Everywhere the shadows became doubled. Romulus never shifted in the sky of this world, but Remus did, following a convoluted apparent path that even the ship's Arab mathematicians had had difficulty puzzling out. And a runner came dashing from the anchored Cetus.
Centurion, there's a report of a riot at the Colonia. The men are in the granary and are threatening to burn down the Principia.
What? Again?
Quintus raised his head to the sky and let out another roar.
Father of the Christ, why do you goad me? With me, Optio.
And he stalked off back to the Cetus. Yuri Eden watched the second sun rise, entranced. Chapter 4. For lack of any clearer orders, it seemed, the troops who had followed their commander out to meet Yuri and Steph waved their short swords and ordered the two travellers to follow Quintus back to the airship.
No funny stuff, mind.
Steph helped Yuri hitch the pack on his back as they followed the men, listening to their gruff speech. She murmured,
So they're all speaking Latin. Or a lineal descendant of classical Latin anyhow,
the Colu said. Reduced to its processing center, the remains of the autonomous colonization unit rode in Yuri's backpack and whispered in their ears through the plugs it had provided, projecting translations of their words at the Romans.
But, said Steph, even I can tell there's a whole bunch of accents in there. Rome always was an amalgam of many nations,
the Colu said.
A forced joining. In the latter days, in the West, provincials, who had been regarded as barbarians in ages before, rose to high command in the Empire. Stilicho, for instance, the best military leader of the late Empire in Western Europe. I admire your grasp of history, Colu,
Steph murmured,
among your other accomplishments. I was programmed to serve as tutor to the children of Yuri's colony on Per Ardua. My knowledge base is broad.
Yuri said,
I think she's ribbing you.
Well, I am happy to serve, even though that destiny has changed.
And so, Steph said, it appears, has the destiny of Rome. The Caesars didn't travel to the stars. They didn't even have airships, as far as I know. Maybe the history you remember is out of date, Colu. I wonder if these Romans ever heard of Stilicho.
You are right, of course. These are not our Romans. We can be guided by our knowledge of our own history, but we must always be aware that things are different here.
Here, on the other side of the hatch,
Yuri said.
The word the Romans are using for the emplacement is actually more like gateway,
the Colu said.
I have chosen to translate it to the more familiar term.
Steph shook her head.
Here we are discussing a whole new history as if it was normal. Are we all going crazy? As if it happened every day.
The Kolyu said softly,
At least we are coping, Colonel Kalinsky.
And Yuri grinned. Besides, didn't it already happen to you once before, Steph, back on Mercury?
It is difficult, though.
Do you think if we stepped back through the hatch, if these goons in fancy dress ever let us, we would find ourselves back where we came from? I mean, on Per Ardua, and with the only Romans in the history books where they belong?
Somehow I doubt it, Yuri Eden,
the Kolyu said.
Having stepped through this door,
we can never go back. If there are Romans here, they're going to be everywhere, right?
We must make the best of it, Yuri Eden. And after all, nobody forced us to come here through the hatch.
Yuri looked drawn, tired, Steph thought. Ill, perhaps. They had all been through a lot this long day, even though, as a glance at her watch showed her, with shock, that not an hour had passed since they'd said their goodbyes to Liu Tao in the middle of the chill far side of Per Ardua, planet of Proxima Centauri. It was obvious they'd travelled a hell of a long way from Proxima, itself 4 light-years from Earth, and travelled more than mere distance. More than just light-years. What was this place? They reached the airship. Steph was shoved none too gently by a legionary's palm towards a rope ladder. She climbed stiffly, followed by Yuri. The two of them, three with the Kolyu, were pushed into a hold at the base of the gondola, roomy but without windows, and lit by a crude-looking fluorescent lamp. They had no view out. They had no seats either. They were made to sit on the floor with their backs to the wooden wall. The soldiers sat around on their cloaks, talking softly and looking speculatively at Steph, who glowered back. The ship, which the Romans called a Cetus, lifted with a smooth acceleration, a hiss of bellows somewhere.
The walls are wooden, Yuri observed, and the floor. I see straw and bloodstains, and the whole thing smells of sheep.
And goats, Steph said, although that could be the legionaries. This has to be some kind of surface patrol vessel. Starship in orbit somewhere? You wonder what kind of technology they must have up there if this is the best they can do down here. If they have colonels,
the Kolyu said,
quite crude enabling technologies may be sufficient for other purposes, such as life support. Colonels, which, incidentally, they refer to as Vulcans, after the god of the forge. I have translated appropriately.
The legionaries watched them suspiciously as they spoke, and Steph was uncomfortably aware of how eerie it might seem to these characters, bored, heavily armed soldiers, if she and Yuri appeared to be listening to a voice, even responding to it, that they couldn't hear. It was almost a relief when one of them grunted,
No talking!
Steph shrugged, but she saw that Yuri's eyes were closed anyhow, his arms folded over the backpack on his lap, his head lolling. It wasn't long before the airship descended. As anchor chains rattled, the legionaries debated briefly among themselves. Then they stood, opened the door to the short corridor down which they'd come to this hold, and shoved the travellers back to the hatch through which they'd clambered aboard the vessel. There they were made to wait until Quintus Fabius and a few of his officers had gone down the ladder to the ground. Steph ducked so she could look out of the hatch. She saw an enclosed compound,
roughly rectangular, laid out over the purple-streaked ground, with walls of sod and what looked like orange-tinged wood, and central buildings of wood and thatch. Carefully, she pulled a slate from her jacket pocket.
"Hey, Collyu, you might want to see this."
She held up the slate to serve as the Collyu's vision.
"Remarkable. Remarkable. A classic Roman legion's marching camp, displaced thousands of years in time and brought across the stars."
They were prodded down the ladder. On the ground, the leader of the little group of soldiers delivered them back to the retinue of Quintus Fabius. Quintus ignored them, but Gnaeus Junius, the second in command, the Optio, Steph learned, waved vaguely.
"Oh, just stand over there and stay out of trouble."
And trouble there was, as Steph could see. Shoved to the periphery, ignored as the Romans bickered among themselves, she tried to make sense of all this. Centurion Quintus was in the middle of some kind of argument with a group of legionaries, most dressed in what Steph was coming to think of as the characteristic style of these post-Romans, much as Roman soldiers had dressed in all the history books and reconstructions she'd seen, even if they were generally drabber, dirtier and more battle-scarred. They all wore heavy belts, with loops for weapons and immense ornate buckles. The belts were the single most striking feature of their costume, she thought, gaudy, almost barbaric. Quintus dominated proceedings in his scarlet cloak and spectacularly plumed helmet. But some others wore various other costumes. One tough-looking woman, short, stocky, red-haired, stood fearlessly close to the centurion. She wore a kind of woolen poncho with tunic, trousers, and boots. There seemed to be military insignia on her shoulder flashes, but nothing like Roman designs. Still, she stood beside Quintus Fabius as if she deserved her place. Alongside her were more men and women dressed much as she was, as well as an older man, dark, with a Mediterranean look to Steph's eyes, wearing a kind of cut-down toga. Steph heard chickens cluck and sheep bleat, and the voices of women and children, as well as the gruffer tones of the men, and she smelled cooking fires. Now she was on the ground, the fort felt less like a military installation than a small town, if fortified. But there was a stronger burning smell, of straw and some kind of wood. A building on fire? As the arguments went on, a line of women, bent low under yokes bearing pails of water, made their way past the knots of soldiers, entirely ignored, eyes downcast. Steph stared. Could these be slaves? Yuri shook his head.
"What a day. We came all this way. We stepped between the stars, and now nobody's paying us any attention."
Steph shrugged.
"People are people. Everybody has their own problems, I guess."
"Yes," said the Collyu. "What we must do is leverage those problems to our advantage."
Steph said,
"Collyu, that messenger told Quintus there was trouble at the Colonia. You think that's what this place is?"
The Collyu murmured in her ear,
"It was the Roman practice to plant colonies of veteran soldiers in a newly occupied province, an easy way of enforcing imperial discipline, an example of Roman culture for newly conquered barbarians, a military reserve, an occupied fortification. Maybe that's what's being set up here. Many of these legionaries, with their families, may not be going home again when the Malleus Jesu leaves this world. Evidently, that's what they're grumbling about."
"A fortification against what?"
Steph thought back.
"We've seen some mighty ruins here, but no sign of an extant civilization. No animal life, even, those clucking chickens aside.
What are these legionaries going to wage war against? A slime mold? Yuri grinned tiredly.
This is an alien world, Steph. I guess it depends on the slime mold.
And also, the Kolyu said, if these Romans can reach this world, so may their rivals. They speak of the Sheen, Steph murmured. Chinese, do you think? The name China has a root in the name of the first dynasty to unify the country. Sheen could be a corruption of that. And the Bricanti, whoever they are.
I am Bricanti.
The woman in the poncho who had been standing with Quintus came striding over.
Whoever you are.
Her language, audible under the translation, was Latin but heavily accented.
I had heard a rumor that Quintus had discovered strangers by his brand new hatch.
Rumors travel fast here, Steph said. The woman laughed.
In a Roman camp, of course they do.
She leaned closer to inspect Steph. Her hair was a deep, proud red, and cropped short. She looked perhaps 40 years old, maybe a quarter century younger than Steph herself, but her face, weather-beaten, made it difficult to tell her age precisely. Her eyes were an icy blue. She said,
"You dress strangely. You smell strangely. I will enjoy hearing your lies about your origin."
Steph grinned. "You probably wouldn't believe me if I told you the truth."
"Ha! That bull-headed centurion might not. We Bricanti have subtler minds. One thing is certain. You did not stow away to this world aboard the Malleus Jesu."
"How do you know that?"
"The ship is mine. This mission is a joint venture of Rome and Eboraki. And if you don't know the Bricanti, you won't know that Eboraki is our capital. In the orbit of the sun, we have our own fleets, Rome and Bricanti, but we cooperate on missions to the stars. Quintus Fabius commands the mission and his Roman louts, but I, Movina, command the vessel and its crew. The Roman term for my role is Triarchus. The ship itself is Bricanti, of course."
"I think I understand." The older man in the toga came over as she spoke.
"It's remarkable, Movina. She speaks softly, in a tongue that, to a stranger like me, sounds like your own, mixed in with German, perhaps. Yet that thing in her ear repeats her words in Latin. But what if we remove it? If I may?"
He reached up to Steph's head. She was uncomfortable with this, but she hardly had a choice. She glanced over at Yuri, who shrugged. She let the man remove her earphone. Movina grinned easily.
"Don't mind Michael. He's the medicus, the ship's doctor. A Greek, like all the best doctors. And like all Greeks, endlessly curious about trivia. I'm speaking in my native tongue now. Can you understand me?"
Steph heard this only indistinctly from Yuri's earphone. Movina's natural tongue, sounding like Danish with a lilt, dominated her hearing. Michael said,
"Say something in your own speech."
Steph grinned.
"If you damage that earphone, I'll break your arm."
"Ha! Remarkable."
He passed back the earphone, which Steph quickly replaced in her ear. And Yuri coughed suddenly. Steph saw that he was leaning on a low rampart wall, and she felt a stab of concern for him. Michael pushed forward.
"Please, let me see if I can help you."
Movina turned to Steph.
Is your companion ill?
Not that I'm aware of.
The Greek is an excellent physician. Far better than these Romans deserve. He will help, if help is possible.
As the doctor approached Yuri, Movina drew Steph aside.
Now, listen to me.
Yes?
I command not only the ship on this mission. I am senior woman. Quintus Fabius has agreed to this.
Senior woman?
Movina sighed.
Do you know soldiers?
I was one myself.
Movina raised her eyebrows.
Very well. Then you will know how soldiers behave. How they have always behaved. The men, anyhow. In the Roman system, you see, the army is all. Their navy is essentially a branch of the army. Whereas in our system, it is the other way around. Which is why our systems mesh together so well when we aren't arguing, Romans and Bricanti. But you need to understand that these Romans are primarily soldiers, and that is how they think of themselves. Most of these legionaries, especially the older ones, have served in war on conventional military missions. Most will probably have seen service in the last Valhallan campaigns against my own people in the northern continent, a war concluded with the latest flawed attempt at a treaty, but probably flaring again by now. And in the south, the Romans' uglier wars with the Sheen grind on. In such wars, women are booty. Or targets. Their bodies are battleground after the men have fallen. Do you understand? Now, this is not a war of conquest. There are no enemies to defeat here, human or otherwise. Nothing to rape and kill. And, of course, the men have been able to bring their wives and sweethearts, even their children. Such is the way of it, for if you sent a ship full of Roman soldiers off on a years-long mission, alone without women, they'd have buggered each other senseless before killing each other over the favours of the prettiest standard-bearers before they got past Augustus.
Augustus?
She frowned.
The seventh planet of the sun. Where do you come from? But look, even with female companions available, men are men. Soldiers are soldiers. And women are targets. The slaves, the celibate servant girls of the Vicarius of Christ, even their comrades' wives and daughters. You, my dear, are not so old nor so ugly that you are safe.
Thanks.
And so we protect each other. As I said, I am senior woman. If you have trouble of that sort, come to me.
I can look after myself.
Good. Do so. And come to me when you fail. Is that clear?
Yes. Thank you.
Very well. Now we should pay attention to these little boys with their quarrel.
Quintus Fabius's voice boomed out, cutting through the arguments.
Titus Valerius, you old rogue! At last you show your face. I might have known you were behind all this trouble.
Through the crowd, Steph could see one of the legionaries being pushed, apparently reluctantly, to the front of a mob of unhappy men. He was burly, with his bare head shaved close, a grizzled grey, and Steph saw one arm terminated in a stump, encased in a wooden cylinder.
Centurion, don't take it out on me. And it wasn't me who set the Principia alight. On the contrary, it was me who organized the bucket chains that...
Pah! Don't give me that, you devil! You were trouble when you were under my father's command, and now you're just as much trouble under mine.
Titus sighed heavily.
Ah, well, if I could afford to retire, I would have long ago, sir. You know that. And I'd take my daughter Claudia home for a decent education and a quiet life, away from the ruffians of your command.
Ha!
Quintus waved a hand at the fort.
This is your retirement, you dolt. A city to command. A world to conquer. Why, I'll appoint you head of the Senate if you like.
Fancy titles aren't for me, sir. And neither is this world.
The Malleus leaves in under a month, and you won't be on it. And if you haven't sorted yourselves out by then...
But that's impossible, sir. That's what we tried to tell you. That's why we had to set the Principia alight, to make you listen.
I thought you said it wasn't you.
Titus grabbed his commander's arm with his one hand.
Listen to me, sir. Our crops won't grow here. The wheat, the barley, even Valhalla potatoes fail, and they grow anywhere. The soil's too dry. Or there's something wrong with it, something missing. You know me, sir. I'm no farmer.
Yes, and you're not much of a soldier either.
No matter what we do, and we've been stirring our shit into this dirt for months now, nothing's working. Why, this reminds me of a time on campaign when...
Spare me your anecdotes! Shit harder, man!
It's not just the dirt, sir.
Titus glanced up at the sky, at the rising second sun of this world.
Some say that bastard Remus is getting bigger.
Bigger?
This world, this sun, is spinning in towards it. What then, sir?
It's hot enough here as it is. If we are to be scorched by two suns... Rubbish!
Quintus proclaimed boldly. The response was angry heckling. He faced the mob bravely, but men on both sides of the argument had their hands on the hilts of their swords. Steph murmured to Movina,
Do the men have a point? Well, they're right about the second sun. This world circles the big ugly star you see up there. That's called Romulus. Romans always called double stars Romulus and Remus. But Romulus and Remus circle a common center of their own. They loop towards and away from each other like mating birds, or like the two bright stars of the Centaur's Hoof, the nearest system to Terra. In a few years, as that second sun swims close, this world will get decidedly hotter than it is now. And then, a few more decades after that, when it recedes, it will get colder.
Steph wondered if this wretched planet was doomed to orbit out of its star's habitable zone when the twin got too close, or even receded too far away.
Has anybody modeled this? I mean, worked out how the climate will change?
I doubt it. And even if they had, no matter how dire the warning, the orders for these men and their families would not vary. From the point of view of the Imperial strategists snug in their villas on the outskirts of Greater Rome, you see, worlds are simple. They are habitable, or they are not. If they are not, they may be ignored. If they are, they must be inhabited by colonia such as this one. Inhabited and farmed. It is just as the Romans took every country in their reach and appended it as a province. All but Prytanique, of course, thanks to the wisdom of Queen Cartimandia, and we Bricanti escaped their net. If this world is not habitable after all for some subtle, long-term reason, bad luck for the colonists. But at least the Sheen won't have it. Do you see? though I must say it will be unfortunate if the very crops won't grow here.
I can make soil.
The Koryu's voice came clearly from Yuri's backpack. Yuri, reluctantly being examined by the Greek doctor, looked alarmed at the sudden direct communication. The Brikanti ship's commander was surprised too. Then, without hesitation, she marched over to Yuri, shoved him around so she could get at his pack, opened it, and peered at the components inside.
What trickery is this?
No trickery, Triarchus. I am a machine, an autonomous colonization unit. I am designed to assist humans in the conquest of alien worlds, and in particular, I can make soil.
If this is true...
Soil is a complex of organisms, many of them microscopic, and nutrients of various kinds. If one of those is missing on this world, I will detect it, and with suitable equipment, can begin the synthesis of supplements, the breeding of organisms. Triarchus, I can make soil.
And your price?
Safety, for myself and my companions.
Movina considered.
You know, I believe you. Impossible as it seems, but then you two, you three, are walking, talking impossibilities already, aren't you? If Quintus Fabius believes this too, and I suspect if he buys off Titus Valerius by offering him and his daughter a ride off this dust bowl, then perhaps the situation can be resolved. And all you want is safety?
Yuri was racked by a coughing spasm. The doctor, looking concerned, helped him to sit.
Safety,
said the Koryu from the pack that was still on Yuri's back,
and medical attention for my friend.
Movina grinned.
How pleasing it will be for me to deliver this miracle to the arrogant Romans. Let me talk to Quintus.
Chapter 5 AD 2213 AUC 2966 By the time the nail struck Mercury, the ISF spacecraft Titania had already been traveling for 3 days. The ship had headed straight out from the Earth-Moon system, away from the Sun, and was more than 3 times as far from the Sun as the Earth when Beth Eden Jones picked up a fragmentary message from her mother.
I'm sorry I had to throw you at General Lix, even if he does owe me a favour. Wherever you end up, I'll come looking for you. Don't forget that I'll always...
And then, immediately after, the flash, dazzling bright, from the heart of the solar system. The bridge was flooded with light. Beth saw them react. Lex McGregor in his captain's chair, straightening his already erect back. Penny Kalinsky grabbing Jiong Yawei's hands in both her own. Earthshine, the creepy virtual persona, seeming to freeze. They all seemed to know what had happened, the significance of the flash. All save Beth.
What?
Beth snapped.
What is it? What happened?
Earthshine turned his weird, artificial face to her. In the years she'd spent in the solar system, Beth had never got used to sharing her world with fake people like him. They have unleashed the wolf of war. We, humanity, we had it bound up with treaties, with words. No more. And now, this.
They being...
The hatch builders. Who else?
And you. You aren't human. You say, we. You have no right to say that.
The virtual looked at her mournfully. I was human once. My name was Robert Brayman. And she stared at him, shocked to the core by the name. Lex McGregor turned to face Penny. So, this is the Colonel's going up. Right, Kalinski?
I think so.
What must we do? We were far enough from the flash for it to have done us no immediate harm, I think. God bless inverse square spreading. What comes next? Penny seemed to think it over.
There'll probably be a particle storm. Like high-energy cosmic rays. Concentrated little packets of energy, but moving slower than light. They'll be here in a few hours. Hard to estimate.
Okay. Maybe I should cut the drive for a while. Turn the ship around so we have the interstellar medium shields between us and Mercury?
Might be a good idea.
Beth didn't understand any of this.
And what of Earth? What's become of Earth?
Penny looked back at her.
Life will recover, ultimately. But for now...
McGregor began the procedure to shut down the main drive and turn the ship around. His voice was calm and competent as he worked through his checklists with his crew. Beth imagined a burned land, a black, lifeless ocean. As it turned out, she was entirely wrong. With the drive off and the acceleration gravity reduced to zero, the crew and passengers of the ISF Colonel Hulk Titania took a break from the situation, from each other. Beth unbuckled her harness, swam out of her couch, and made her clumsy way to the bathroom, locked herself in, and just sat, eyes closed, trying to regulate her breathing. Trying not to think. But then she heard the rest talking, and the crackle of radio messages. Voices speaking what sounded to Beth like a mashup of Swedish and Welsh. 30 minutes after the Colonel drive had been shut down, and the screen of high-energy particles and short-wavelength radiation from its exhaust dissipated, the first signals from the inner system were being received by the Titania's sprawling antennas. Gathered once more on the bridge of the Titania, the passengers and crew listened to the fragmentary voices, staring at each other, uncomprehending. Beth looked around at the group, in this first moment of stillness since the Titania had flung itself away into space from Earth's moon. Herself, Beth Eden Jones, 36 years old, born on a planet of Proxima Centauri, but brought back to Earth by a mother who was now, presumably, burned to a crisp on Mercury. But not before she had forced Beth to take this new journey into strangeness. General Lex McGregor of the ISF, a monument of a man in his 70s, commander of this space fleet ship, looking professionally concerned, but unperturbed. Even his voice was soothing, or at least it was for Beth. McGregor, like Beth's father, Yuri Eden, was British, but McGregor had grown up in Anglaterre, the southern counties of England heavily integrated into a European federation, while Yuri had been born in an independent North Britain. And to Beth's ear, McGregor's accent had the softest of French intonations as a result. Penny Kalinski, some kind of physicist who had known Beth's mother, herself nearly 70, looking bewildered. No, Beth thought. She was scared on some deeper level, as if all this strangeness was somehow directed at her personally. Jiong Yawei, a 40-year-old Chinese who had some antique relationship with Penny and who had got swept up on the wrong side of the UN-Chinese war that looked to have exploded across the solar system. The two young members of the Titania's bridge crew, Junior ISF officers, male and female, looking equally confused. But, Beth thought, as long as McGregor was around and captain of this hulk, they didn't need to think, didn't need to care, regardless of the bonfire of the worlds they had fled, and now the utter strangeness leaking through the communication systems. McGregor would take care of them. Or such was their comforting illusion. And, creepiest of all, Earthshine. An artificial intelligence, with the projected body of a smartly dressed 40-something male, and a look of calm engagement on his face. An appearance that was, Beth knew, a mendacious simulation. A ghost of light. The closest to reality Earthshine came was an ugly lump of technology stowed away somewhere on this vessel. A store of the memory and trickling thoughts that comprised his artificial personality. He was a creature who, with his two brothers, locked deep in high technology caverns on the Earth, had exerted real power over all humanity for decades. And he'd told her his true name. Or one of them. Robert Brayman. He'd known Beth would understand the significance for her. All her life, and especially since being brought to Earth against her will, she'd been reluctant to get involved in her parents' past, the muddled old Earth society from which they'd been expelled before they'd come to the emptiness of Per Ardua, planet of Proxima Centauri, where Beth had been born, her home. Nothing had changed in that regard now. She could see Earthshine was still waiting for some kind of reaction from her. She turned away from him deliberately. McGregor swiveled in his command couch and surveyed them all with a kind of professional sympathy.
"I know this is difficult," he began. "It's only days since we fled what was apparently a catastrophic war in the inner solar system. We feared... well... we feared the destruction of everything, of the space colonies, even the Earth itself. We had no specific destination in mind. My mission, mine and my crew's, was essentially to save you, sir."
And he nodded to Earthshine.
"That was my primary order, coming from the UN Security Council and my superiors in the ISF, in the hope that you could lead a rebuilding program to follow."
"And the rest of us," said Penny Kalinske dryly, "were swept up in Earthshine's wake." McGregor faced her. He was still handsome, Beth thought, despite his years, and he had a charisma that was hard not to respond to. He said,
"That's the size of it. Of course, you, Miss Jones, are here because... well, because I owed a favour to your mother. Ancient history. However, whatever the fates that brought us together, here we are in this situation now. As to what that situation is..."
He glanced at his juniors. Responding to the prompt, the young woman raised a slate. Aged maybe 25, Beth guessed, she was solidly built with a rather square face. Her blonde hair was tightly plaited. A tag stitched on her jumpsuit read ISF Lieutenant Marie Golvan, alongside the ISF logo. Beth noted absently that she had a small crucifix pinned beside the tag. Tapping at her slate, Golvan summarized quickly.
"Sir, we accelerated for a full gravity for 3 days. We shut down the drive, but we're still cruising at our final velocity of just under 1% light speed."
She glanced around at the passengers, evidently wondering how much they could understand of the situation.
"We set off from lunar orbit and headed directly out from the sun. We're currently 3 astronomical units from the sun. That is... deep in the asteroid belt. and still heading outward.
But now we're looking back, Earthshine said. Now that the drive exhaust is no longer screening our ability to look and listen. And instead of news from a shattered Earth, we're receiving...
messages, all right,
Golvan said.
But messages we don't understand.
She tapped her slate, and fragments of speech filled the air, distorted, soaked by static, ghost voices speaking and fading away.
To begin with,
Golvan said,
these are all radio broadcasts, like 20th century technology, not like the laser and other narrow-beam transmission methods the ISF and the space agencies of our competitors use nowadays. In fact, we picked them up not with the Titania's comm system, but with a subsidiary antenna meant for radio astronomy and navigation. The messages don't seem to be intended for us. They're leakage, essentially, that we are picking up fortuitously.
Jiong said, maybe these are from scattered communities, on Earth and beyond. Radio is all they can improvise. Requests for help, for news?
I don't think so, Sel,
Golvan said politely.
For one thing, the distribution is wrong. We're picking up these messages from all around the plane of the ecliptic. That is, all around the sky, the solar system. From bodies where we have no colonies. None of us, either UN or Chinese, such as the moons of Jupiter and Saturn, some of the smaller asteroids.
Survivors, then, Jiong suggested. In ships, fleeing as we are. Golvan shook her head with a scrap of impatience.
Sir, there hasn't been time. Nobody can have fled much further and faster than we did. And besides, there's the question of the languages.
Beth listened again to the voices coming from the slate, both male and female, some speaking languages that were almost hauntingly familiar, yet not quite. Earthshine said, I can help with some of this. My own systems are interfaced with the ships. I have a rather more extensive language analysis and translation suite than the vessel's own. McGregor grunted, as if moved to defend his vessel. Nobody expected the Titania to need such a suite, sir. Evidently, the situation has changed, Earthshine said smoothly. There seem to be three main clusters in these messages. Three languages, or language groups. The first, the most common, actually, is what sounds like a blend of Scandinavian languages, Swedish, Danish, mixed with old Celtic tongues. Gaelic, Breton, Welsh. The grammar will take some unpicking. Much of the vocabulary is relatively straightforward. He glanced at Jiong. The second group you might recognize. Jiong, frowning, was struggling to listen. It sounds like Han Chinese, he said, but heavily distorted. A regional dialect, perhaps?
We are hearing this from all over the solar system, Golvan said. If it's a dialect, it's somehow become a dominant one.
Penny asked,
and the third group?
Golvan said calmly,
actually, that's the easiest to identify. Latin.
There was a beat, a shocked silence. McGregor said, I might add that we've had no reply to our attempted communications by conventional means with ISF command centers. And of course, we haven't replied to any of these radio fragments. The question now is what we should do about all this. Penny nodded.
I don't think we have many options. I take it this vessel can't flee to the stars.
McGregor smiled. This is, or was, a testbed for new kernel technologies, to replace the generation of ships that first took your parents, Beth, to Proxima Centauri. But it's not equipped for a multi-year interstellar flight. No. In fact, we don't even have the supplies for a long stay away from dock. As you know, our escape from the moon was arranged in something of a panic.
We need to land somewhere soon,
Beth said. That's the size of it.
But where?
Well, we don't have to decide immediately. We're still speeding out of the solar system, remember? It took us 3 days under full power to accelerate up to this velocity. It will take another 3 days just to slow us to a halt before we can begin heading back into the inner system. Golvan said,
And then we will have a journey of several more days to wherever we choose as our destination. We'll have plenty of time to study the radio communications, maybe even make some telescopic observations of the worlds. Maybe,
she said brightly,
we'll even be in touch with ISF or the UN by then.
I doubt that very much,
Penny said dryly.
Yes, said Earthshine, watching her. You understand, don't you, Penny Kalinsky? You suspect you know what's happened to us. Because it's happened to you before.
McGregor stared at him, frowning, evidently unsure what he meant. Let's not speculate. Look, I'm in command here. But the situation is novel. I'd rather proceed on the basis of consensus. I'll give the order to fire up the drive for deceleration. Do I have your agreement for that? When we've come to a halt, we'll review our situation. We'll make decisions on our next steps based on the information we have to hand then.
Good plan,
Penny said.
Unless by then somebody makes those decisions for us. Think about it. We're in a massive ship with a highly energetic drive, about to plunge back into a solar system where, well, where we may not be recognized. We'll be highly visible.
Fair point. But we have no choice. All agreed? Then if I can ask you to prepare for the burn, to make your way to your couches and lock down any loose gear.
Chapter 6. The Triarchus of the Brachanti vessel Ikelwith was known to her crew, as she was known to her family and associates, only by her given name, Karis. It was a custom of the Brachanti, especially those Pretanique-born, to eschew the complex family name structures of their fiercest rivals, the Romans, all of whom seemed to trace their lineages all the way back through various senatorial clans to the Romans' Etruscan forebears, and also the traditions of the Brachanti's oldest allies, the Scand, with their complicated son or daughter of this fellow naming convention, such as the tongue-twisting surname of Ari Guthfrithson, the druid who stood before Karis now, rather ill at ease in the commander's cabin, and looking at her with growing exasperation.
Triarchus, I get the sense you're not listening to me.
Karis allowed herself a grin.
Well, you're right, druid Ari, and I apologize. It's just we've been so busy prospecting like crazy at this latest teardrop before we move on to the next and the next, following a schedule drawn up by some idiot in Dumnona with a blank parchment and a blanker mind and absolutely no experience of what life is actually like out here in the expanses of Ema's skull. And you walk in with this incomprehensible news of... what? A ship out in the void?
A ship that shouldn't be there, Triarchus.
You see what I mean? Incomprehensible. Would you like a drink? I'm stocked up with the usual.
Meaning Brachanti mead and Scand beer. Ari raised an eyebrow. I haven't heard the rumors that you have some wine from Italia tucked away in here, by the way.
Hmph,
Karis said, reaching for the relevant bottle in a compartment of her desk. The Roman bottle was pottery, shaped like a miniature amphora, and came with a couple of matching mugs into which she poured the ruby wine, working with care with the ship's thrust operating at less than full weight.
You've sophisticated tastes for one so immature.
I'm 29 years old, Triarchus, he said, sipping his drink.
Younger than me by the best part of a decade, by Thor's left arse cheek.
Well, I am a druid, Karis. The word derived from an old Bricanti word for oak, Karis knew, and signified great knowledge. Ari was one of the generalist scholars that all Bricanti ships carried, if they had the room, as opposed to specialists in ship engineering or in navigation in the deep ocean of vacuum the Bricanti called Ema's Skull, or in other essential functions. Ari was assigned here to explore the unknown, to study and categorize the new. After all, each of the fragments of ice and stone and metal that made up the giant belt of worldlets known as the Tears of Ema, resource loads it was the Ekelwith's mission to survey, was a new country in its own right. You never knew what you were going to find.
Here's to Druid, then,
Karis said, raising her mug.
And let's get back to work before we're too drunk to concentrate. What of this ship you found?
Not me, in fact, Triarchus. Your astronomers were using their far watches, fixing our position and mapping a sky full of Ema's teardrops, as they do day and night.
Or so they claim in their duty logs.
They spotted this thing. A point of light in the sky, moving steadily. You understand, Triarchus, that if you split open the spectrum of the light from such an object, you can learn about its nature and trajectory.
I may not be a druid, but I know that much.
I apologize. Well, the astronomers had thought it was just another teardrop, previously unmapped, or perhaps a hairy star wandering in from the greater void. Karis prompted,
but in fact,
this object is beyond the main belt of Ema's teardrops. It is heading nearly directly away from our position, away from the sun, in fact. Its apparent motion across our field of view is quite small, but it is receding swiftly. Not only that, the object is actually decelerating. You can tell that from the shifting shadow bands in the unfolded light.
Yes, Druid, thank you.
I apologize again.
Decelerating. Is this a ship?
Yes, Triarchus. You won't be surprised to know that the split light shows it to be using a kernel drive, like the ships of all the empires. But it is not a configuration we recognize. Not from any of the empires. Not ours, not Roman or Sheen.
You have challenged it?
We have. Or rather, our signalers have, following my suggestion.
Maybe I should have been informed before such a step was taken.
Ari Guthrithson sighed and poured them both some more Roman wine. Would you have paid attention, Triarchus? Your mind has been focused, rightly, on the operations at the teardrop, and our course to the next. The hail was routine. It was thought best not to disturb you until...
All right,
she said grumpily.
I take it no reply was received to our hail.
None. We have, in fact, heard the rogue being hailed by other vessels. Roman and Sheen both. Again, we have heard no reply. Karis frowned. But if it's not Bricanti or Roman or Sheen, then what? Some kind of pirate?
If so, evidently formidable. That's the situation, Triarchus. Given the deceleration we can see, we know that this rogue will slow to a halt in 3 days. We also happen to know that the Ikelwith is the closest Brakanti vessel to the object, and we have the chance to be first to intercept. Kiris eyed the druid.
I think you're telling me a decision point is approaching.
At which you will need to report back to the fleet headquarters at Dumnona, Triarchus. If we were to abandon our mission here and intercept the rogue...
When will it come to a halt?
2 more days. By which time... Ari grabbed a bit of parchment and quickly sketched positions. Ema, the god who built the cosmos, made a single stride from the sun to the place where he built Midgard. He said, a bit of rote taught to all students of interplanetary navigation at the college at Dumnona, and it amused Karras that he used the old Brakanti word for the world rather than the Roman terra, long incorporated into his people's everyday language.
Here we are about 3 Ema strides from the sun. The rogue is here, more than half a stride further out, but along a different radius from our own. We calculate that if it keeps decelerating as it is, we've no guarantee about that, of course, it will come to a halt here in about 3 days, further out along that radius, about 5 strides from the sun.
Karras spanned the distance between Ikelwith and the rogue with her hand.
If you've drawn this roughly accurately, then we are perhaps 2 Ema strides from the rogue's final position. And we have 3 days to get there? Could we do that?
The engineers say that we could do it with a double-weight acceleration load all the way, a day and a half out, a day and a half to decelerate.
The crew will love that.
Ari said dryly,
they will relish the challenge. Perhaps. You advise me well, Ari.
It was clear to Karras that her commanders would order her to intercept this rogue, if she could, to be the first there, beating the Sheen, the Romans. The Brakanti were the weakest of the 3 great powers of Earth, spread thin along their marginal realm, a vast terrain of mostly unproductive land, the northern coasts of the Eurasian landmass, the Scand countries, Pretanique and Iveriu, and the northern reaches of Valhalla Superior, though that was under constant threat from the Roman legions, whose roads and marching camps crisscrossed the great plains to the south of that vast continent. Since the days 2 millennia past, when Queen Cartimandia had used guile to persuade the Romans under Claudius to invade Germania rather than Pretanique, the Brakanti and their allies had relied for their survival not on brute strength, not on numbers and vast armies, but on cunning, on ability and knowledge. And the chance to acquire new knowledge was never to be passed up. That was why the Ikelwith was out here scouting for treasure amid the tears of Ema in the first place. The rogue ship represented opportunity. An unknown opportunity, but an opportunity even so. It would be Karras's duty to grasp that opportunity, she was sure. She began to roll up her charts of Ema's tears.
Well, Ari, if I am to speak to Dumnona, I will need a draft mission plan. I don't think we'll be allowed to ignore this.
Ari stood. I took the liberty of getting that process started already, Triarchus.
You know me too well. Get on with it then, and I'll make my way to the communicators.
Chapter 7. The Titania finally drew to a halt 5 astronomical units from the sun. Halted in emptiness. This was the orbit of Jupiter, Beth was told. A giant, bloated world with a retinue of moons like a miniature solar system in itself,
a world that would have dwarfed any planet in the Proxima system, even the Pearl, which had been bright in the permanent daylight of the Per Ardua sky. But this monster among planets was on the far side of the sky just now, invisibly remote, and the ship hung in a void, star-scattered, where even the mighty local sun was a mere speck of fire, a source of sharp rectilinear shadows. If only Jupiter had been closer, Beth thought, there might not be this sense of abandonment, of isolation. But they were not alone. The foreign ship had already been waiting for them here, even as, after 3 days of burning the kernel drive, the Titania's velocity relative to the sun was reduced to zero. The Titania had been repeatedly hailed, over radio frequencies Marconi could have exploited, and Earthshine had at last been able to put together a rough translation. This was a vessel called the Ikelwydd, which was a word similar to the Welsh for mistletoe. It was part of a fleet commanded from a place called Dumnona, which Earthshine speculated might be in Britain, on Earth. That fleet was a military arm of a nation, or federation, called something like the Bricanti. As the Titania was not recognized as a vessel either of the Bricanti or of the Latin speakers, or the Sheen, and as it refused to respond to any hails, it would be regarded as a pirate and treated as such. The Ikelwydd was evidently a kernel drive ship like the Titania, and its basic hull was a cylindrical shape, like the Titania's, the most obvious design choice in response to the high thrust levels of the kernel drive, and, according to McGregor, it had blasted out here at multiple gravities to overhaul the Titania. Even from the first glimpse, Penny thought, the Ikelwydd had the look of a fighting ship, with an evidently massive hull, heavy armour around the kernel drive units in the base of the ship, and what looked like scarring, the result of weapons fire, in the insulation that swathed the main body. Hours after the first encounter, still the hails came from the Bricanti ship, and still the crew of the Titania failed to reply. All on board the lightly manned Titania, passengers, Lex McGregor, his command crew, and the three strong engineering crew who Beth hadn't even seen before now, were ordered up to the bridge for this extraordinary encounter. 10 people, Beth thought, if you included Earthshine as a person. 10 survivors of Earth and Moon and the UN-Chinese War. 10 survivors. Of a whole history that seemed to have been lost here, if the ship waiting to meet them was anything to judge by. Now, Penny said dryly,
Lex, explain again the logic of why we're just sitting here.
He sighed. Penny, the Titania looks tough, but she's no warship, unlike that bird of prey out there. You saw the way she maneuvered when she moved in close. Swept in like a bloody spitfire. Conversely, we're a hulk, literally, a scow for carrying garbage and passengers. We've nothing to fight with.
Save a couple of handguns,
said one young engineer sourly. Yes, thank you, Kapoor. All we can do is bluff. At least give an impression of strength by not jumping when we're ordered to. Believe me. In many confrontations, posture is everything. Why, I remember when I was boxing champion 4 years in a row at the ISF Academy, I could win a fight just by the way I looked at my opponent at the weigh-in.
Penny said, Perhaps we ought to stick to the point. Fascinating though your anecdotes always are, Lex.
Earthshine turned to her, his face blank, expressionless. Eerily so, Penny thought. He said,
But what is the point, Colonel Kalinske?
Sooner or later, we must all face the reality of what has happened here. But you, most of all, you should be our guide. Because
it has happened to you before, hasn't it? He had hinted at such secrets previously, Beth realized, but not so openly. Now, every eye on the bridge was on Penny. She scowled at Earthshine.
That's my business. My personal business.
Not since you and your impossible sister came to see me in Paris all those years ago. And we visited your parents' graves. Do you remember?
Of course you do.
And there on the stone of your mother was proof that your sister... No, you were the impossible one, weren't you? It's so easy to get confused, isn't it? But since then, you see, since that strange day, decades ago, I have been involved in your secret, in your peculiarly twisted lives.
Much good it's done any of us.
At least it has given us a clue as to the nature of the transfiguration we have now endured. From a solar system riven by war, to this new landscape with a warrior bird spaceship called Ikelwith that hails us in a mixture of Norse and Gaelic. Lex MacGregor shook his head. Earthshine, as we stand in peril from an alien battleship, what the hell are you talking about? We live in strange times, Captain. Times when the fabric of reality has a tendency to come unstuck, and then to ravel itself up again, but with flaws. That battleship wouldn't belong in our reality, as we do not belong here, as Steph Kalinsky, once an only child, did not belong in a reality inhabited by her twin sister, Penny, here. Everything changed that day when the Mercury hatch was first opened for Steph Kalinsky. Now, with the huge pounding of the UN-China war, perhaps everything has changed for the rest of us. Light flashed from a dozen screens all around the deck.
Missile fire!
It was Engineer Kapoor who had shouted, pointing at the nearest screen. Beth saw fast-moving lights, an impossibly bright glare. Golvan had to expand the field of view of the screens to give an image that made sense. The Brakanti ship still hung in space, but sparks of fire had swept out of emplacements in that battered hull, were sailing out into space, and were turning, visibly converging on the screen's viewpoint, on the Titania.
I guess they ran out of patience,
Penny said.
Get to your couches!
MacGregor yelled, pushing his way to his own position.
Strap in! Golvan, their trajectories!
The birds are heading for the lower third of the fuselage. I'm seeing kernel radiations, Captain. The missiles are kernel-tipped, kernel-driven.
Penny and Jiong pulled each other through the air to couches side by side, back from the control positions. They strapped in hastily, then grabbed each other's hands. Jiong said,
After all we've been through, we're not dead yet, Jiong Yahweh.
Beth, isolated in her couch, longed to be closer to them, closer to anybody, to have a hand to hold. MacGregor glanced over his shoulder.
Everybody in place? Good. Those birds are closing. Brace!
When the missile struck, it felt as if the whole ship rang like a gong. The roar of noise passed quickly, to be replaced by a chorus of alarm howls from the bridge instruments, and panels glared with warnings of catastrophic failures. The crew worked quickly, going over their displays, shouting complex technical data to each other. The Titania was tumbling, Beth gathered, falling out of what must have been a spectacular explosion. She could feel the slow wheeling as the rump of the ship turned over and over.
The pressure bulkheads are holding,
Kapoor called. Golvan said,
Captain, the strike was surgical. They hit a circumference around the hull. The blasts were shaped, I think.
They cut away our lower third.
McGregor growled. So they snipped off the kernel drive. Penny said,
These Brichanti, whoever they are, use kernel technology as routine weapons of war. Even we never went that far, not until the nail, the last desperate throw. To fight our kernel war, we had to improvise. What kind of people are they?
You might soon find out, McGregor said grimly. A party is cutting its way through the outer airlock door. They must have come aboard before launching those stingers. Oh, put away your popgun, Kapoor. Resisting will only get us killed the quicker.
We don't belong here, Penny said. Earthshine's right. Any more than I belonged in Steph's reality after the Mercury hatch. My God, Lex, these characters make you look like a UN diplomat.
Now, the lights started to go out all over the bridge, Beth saw. Even the screens went dark, displays fritzing to emptiness. The bridge crew hammered their touchpads and keyboards and slates and yelled instructions into microphones, without success.
It's all shutting down, Golvan said. We're losing everything.
McGregor demanded, Is it the Brichanti? Jiong said,
They communicate by crude radio. I would be surprised if they could hack into our sophisticated information systems to do this.
And Beth turned to look at Earthshine. While the rest of the bridge shut down, even the main lights were flickering now, he seemed to be glowing, oddly, from within, as if transfigured. A golden light.
You,
she said.
It's not the Brichanti doing this. This isn't part of their attack. It's you, Earthshine.
McGregor turned on him. What the hell are you doing to my ship, you old monster? Earthshine stood up from his couch, his virtual body passing through the harness. Saving you all. General, the only asset we have in this reality is the knowledge we bring from where we came from. I have taken that knowledge into myself, for safekeeping. Even the ship's physical systems are being destroyed, now they are drained of data. The Brichanti have captured a useless hulk. I will use the knowledge I have stored in myself to bargain for our lives. McGregor roared.
And who the hell put you in charge?
I just did. And now, I think... The door slid open. A party of figures floated into the bridge without ceremony, in clunky pressure suits of what looked like leather and steel ribbing, each bearing a stylized rifle with bayonet fixed. They all had their faceplates open, and they stared around at what was evidently a very unfamiliar environment. At a quiet word from a central figure, they spread out quickly into the bridge, one standing over each crew member or passenger. Beth found herself facing a short, squat, heavily built man. She had to raise her hand to shield her eyes from a flashlight attached to the weapon that he shone in her face.
Nobody resist, McGregor murmured. We're in their hands now.
The leader of the invading party lowered her rifle. She was a woman, pale complexion, perhaps 40-ish, and she made straight for Lex McGregor, the obvious command figure. She spoke, softly but firmly, and Beth heard a simultaneous translation come from a speaker on a console.
My name is Karras. I command the vessel Ikelwith.
I know who you are. Earthshine stepped towards her. The warriors tried to block his way and waved their weapons at him, but the golden figure simply walked through them. A couple of men broke away, evidently panicked by this eerie display. The commander, however, stood her ground. Triarchus Karras, My name is Earthshine, and we need to talk. Chapter 8 AD 2222 AUC 2975 It took a month after Steph and Yuri emerged from the hatch before the Malleus Jesu was ready to depart from the double star system of Romulus and Remus for Earth, or Terra, as the Romans and Bricanti called it. The setting up of the permanent colonia continued apace, even as ferry craft blasted up to the orbiting starship, carrying away personnel, equipment, and supplies for the return journey. Steph was bemused to observe that the ferries themselves were driven by small clusters of kernels, Vulcans, as the Romans called the energetic wormhole-like anomalies, even in the atmosphere of an inhabited planet like this one. No such craft had ever been allowed anywhere near the surface of the Earth, her Earth, not before the final war of 2213, anyhow. Early one morning, with 6 days left to departure, Steph Kalinsky was approached by a Bricanti who introduced herself only as Aelid. Tall, spare, Aelid was dressed much as Triarchus Movina was, in a hooded woolen poncho, trousers, boots. But unlike Movina, Aelid wore a heavy belt, as the Romans wore, with a gaudy brass buckle and loops for weapons, though empty. Steph, as had become her habit, had been spending her free time at the hatch site with her slate, trying, ineffectually, to learn a little more of the physics of the enigmatic emplacement. Now Aelid asked Steph if she would care to join her in a final aerial tour by Cetus of the area around the Colonia site. Steph guessed Aelid was maybe 50, a little older than Movina, but a good deal younger than Steph herself.
I might have taken you for a Roman with that belt. The Triarchus Movina remains independent of the Roman military command. I, on the other hand, am officially a tribune, an officer subordinate to the Centurion. I am a kind of liaison between the two command structures. Complicated, I know, but it seems to work. As to the tour, we seek to complete our mappings of this place, and we have photographers, artists, to capture the likenesses of the structures left behind by the indigenes. We want to leave with some record of this world as it exists before the children of these Roman soldiers breed like rabbits and dismantle the fortress mountains for building materials for their military roads. I myself am a command officer, but serve the Triarchus as a druid, a scholar, hence my own interest. I have undergone some of the training. Will you come?
I'd bite your hand off.
Aelid pulled a face.
A vivid expression, and oddly Roman. This was Movina's idea. We would be fascinated by your response. We'll be gone a couple of days. Bring what you need. We leave in an hour.
So, in the unchanging light of Romulus, and as trumpet blasts roused the Roman colonia from its slumber for the first watch of a new day, Steph stood side by side with Aelid before the big observation window of one of the expedition's 2 Cetus airships, as the ground fell away beneath them. Steph looked for the small barracks block where Yuri was resting, with the Kolyu for company. Away from the Kolyu, Steph would be supported in her translation by the buds in her ears, themselves smart little gadgets. Aelid gestured to the west, where mountains strode across the landscape. The sky was clear, and Romulus cast a pearly light that spun shadows across the mountain chain, sharp and unvarying.
Most of the interesting structures are to be found in the mountains, so that's where we'll make our way. This expedition is only a final reconnaissance.
The Arab navigation team, with their far watchers, working from orbit, have mapped much of the planet. And with our two Cetus craft, we've completed two circumnavigations, one equatorial from substellar to antistellar, and the other pole to pole. The far side is, of course, masked by ice, as are the shadow faces of all worlds like these, huddling close to their suns. But the air remains breathable, and there is life, and some structure.
She smiled.
I have spent happy hours with Centurion Quintus Fabius and his staff studying these maps, plotting the routes of roads yet to be built, ports and transport nodes to be founded at river confluences and estuaries, sketching the provinces to be carved out of these silent landscapes some day. There have even been war games, military exercises, as Quintus and his boys have imagined how to counter new Hannibals marching through those sculpted mountains.
You are Bricanti,
Steph said carefully.
I understand that Bricanti is a distinct nation, independent of the Romans and their empire.
Aelid looked at her sideways.
You really do know nothing, Gavas. Yes, Bricanti is an independent nation. The heartland is Pretanique, an island separated from the mainland of Europa, and therefore from the Romans' ancient holdings.
Steph hazarded,
an island the Romans called Britannia?
Well, they still do, in their arrogance. For most of our history, we've traded with Rome peaceably enough. The Romans are the better soldiers, we are the better sailors. We build on the expertise of our scanned cousins, who have always been expert shipbuilders, back to the days of longships with their wooden hulls and woolen sails. When the Scand first burst from their northern fastnesses, they had run out of land to parcel out to too many sons, they were pirates and raiders, and the Bricanti and the Romans made a rare show of unity to beat them back. But it was the Bricanti, in the end, who forged alliances with the Scand. We had far-seeing leaders in those days, unlike the current lot, who were able to see the potential of this new nation of warriors and traders. There was a kind of revolution of the heart. With Scand ships and their expansive spirit, Bricanti stopped being a rather defensive ally of the Empire and began to forge its own global ambitions. Now our own northern empire stretches across the reaches of Europa, and also Asia, where we have a long frontier with the Sheen. We are one of the three great powers, I suppose you might say, who dominate Europa, Asia, Africa between us. And we battle over the spoils of the Valhallan continents to the west, much to the chagrin of the native inhabitants.
She tapped her heavy soldier's belt.
But Valhalla is an arena useful for developing military capabilities.
Steph said,
And you are able to work with the Romans?
Yes. At this time we are officially at peace. The two of us are closer to each other than either of us is to the Sheen. In other ages, the pattern changes, though the underlying relationships endure.
Your culture is different from the Romans in other ways,
Steph said.
Women are stronger.
Aelid grinned.
Well, the Romans have strong women too, but they are powers behind the throne. The wives and mothers and sisters of emperors and generals. Our culture has a history of strong women going back to Cartamandia, who saved us from the Romans.
She looked at Steph.
Is this a story you know? It is 2,000 years old. Every Bricanti child could tell it.
Steph shrugged.
You see, Julius Caesar had already set foot in our island,
and had planted the dream of conquest in the Romans' empty heads. 50 years later, Cartimandia, queen of a realm in the north, was informed that the time had come, that the legions were massing in Portus Itius on the coast of Gaul for the invasion. It was she who travelled in person to Rome, she who managed to persuade Emperor Claudius that there was much greater glory to be gained if he turned his legions north, into Germania Transrhenus, which even his glorious predecessor Augustus had failed to conquer. Continental provinces would be easier to consolidate for the Romans, and besides, she pledged to become an ally of Rome, so that the invasion was unnecessary. She made a good case, it was said, much to the surprise of many Romans. But, despite the Romans' prejudice at the time, and despite what Caesar said about us, we were no hairy savages, and Cartimandia was sophisticated and wily. Well, it was Outer Germania that felt the tramp of the legionary's boot, and not the fields of Prytanique. Cartimandia, with some Roman help, went on to consolidate her hold on the whole of southern Prytanique, and her successors made themselves valuable allies of Rome by becoming a secure exporter of grain, wool, and leather to supply the empire's continental armies. The Bricanti have never forgotten the achievements of Cartimandia, and forever since, Bricanti women have won positions of power.
Steph and Yuri had quietly talked over some of this with the Kolyu, as they speculated how this history had diverged from their own. In the account lodged in the Kolyu's memory, at the time of the invasion of Britain, a woman Roman historians knew as Cartimandua.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.